Hello and a very warm welcome on behalf of NTI Audio. I will present to you the vibration measurements of the XL2. My name is Markus Becker and I am assisted today by Brno Nikš, who will mainly take care of your incoming questions and respond to them during the presentation. The topics that we have prepared for you start with an overview of some application examples, followed by terms and definitions related to vibration analysis. We will also introduce into the units and metrics, as well as the sensors. We will furthermore cover the measurements that are supported by our instruments before we come to the practical presentation that I have prepared for you. Towards the end, I will summarize the key information of this webinar and provide some additional hints and tips. I expect that the overall webinar will take around half an hour. Let us first take a look at typical application examples. Here we have a train passing by close to a house, to a building. And here we have the challenge of assessing the vibrations in the walls of this building. This would be one of the typical applications. A second one would be the quality control, for instance, in an assembly line. So we have good working machines and those who are vibrating, who have possibly an out of balance problem. And for that reason, we need to identify these faulty devices and sort them out. A third application could be the probing of vibration sources in a bigger assembly line or any machinery, any major installation which suffers under apparent vibrations. So localizing these sources may be a challenge that can be covered by this test. Now let us first take a look at the fundamental definitions of vibration analysis. Here we have a cantilever that is apparently vibrating. And when we want to represent the movement of the tip of this cantilever up and down over time, we can do that by approximately drawing here a sine wave. So the up and down movement of this cantilever tip would be represented by this sine wave. Now, when we look at the velocity of this movement, here we have the displacement. Now, coming to the velocity, we notice that at the point where the cantilever is moving through this zero crossing line, we have the highest velocity, the highest speed. Whereas at the top and the bottom end point, the velocity comes down to zero before it changes its direction. So we have a 90 degree phase shift between displacement and velocity. Next would come the acceleration, and the acceleration has another 90 degree phase shift because at the point of where the velocity changes from positive to negative, the acceleration is maximum or minimum. Now, when we would represent this sine curve here by a mathematical formula, we would choose this form, whereby d stands for the displacement here in this top of this sine wave. The term 2pf stands for the frequency and t is the time. Now when we solve this equation for the velocity and acceleration, we get these two formulas. So we have a formula for the velocity, which is 2pf times the displacement, or when we look for the acceleration, that would be 2pf times the velocity divided by the gravitation constant, g. Now let's take a look what happens when we increase the frequency of the vibration. Here we have doubled the vibrating frequency. Now due to this term 2pf, the velocity will follow the frequency, of course, but the amplitude of the velocity will be higher than of the displacement. If we double the frequency, we have double amplitude of the velocity. And talking about the acceleration, we have even quadrupled the peak, the amplitude, towards the displacement. frequency stays the same. Now, apparently this term 2PF plays an important role because it shows up in all these formulas. It is a little bit an awkward number because of P being an irrational number. And let us now equal 1000. In that case, we can solve this for F, which means the frequency would be 159 Hertz. Why do we do that? Because when we have a vibration of 159 Hertz, apparently there is a pretty straight correlation between the acceleration is 1000, here 1000 times the velocity divided through g, or the velocity is 1000 times higher than the displacement. That is the reason why this frequency F plays an important role in the world of vibration analysis. It is sometimes referred as a typical reference frequency and used, for instance, for calibrators. Let us take another look at the same relationship between these three terms, displacement, velocity, and acceleration. Here on this graph, you see a double logarithmic scale, and we have an average velocity which stays constant over the frequency. Now, if we would plot the displacement in this graph, we would result in a straight line coming down from high displacements at low frequencies down to very small displacements at high frequencies. On the other side, when we do it the same for the acceleration, we start at low acceleration at low frequencies, rising linearly here up to high acceleration values for higher frequencies. And the point where these three lines cross each other is again our 159 Hertz frequency. Please keep in mind that the unit of these three terms, displacement, is here displayed in micrometer, which is 1000 times smaller than millimeter, velocity expressed in millimeter per second, and millimeter is 1000 times smaller than meter, meter per second square, for the acceleration. So under this condition, we have this cross point here of the 159 Hertz. Now, as we are talking about units, we can express these terms either in metric units or in imperial units, meter or inches as the base. We can display the results as peak values. So here, when we look at the time plot of our incoming signal, the peak to peak is this represented by this bar here, or just the peak. Peak means from the zero crossing line or the middle line to the peak. So half of this one would be the peak result. We can calculate the RMS, the root mean square, represented by this dotted blue line here. Or we can take a look at the maximum or minimum, the maximum value, for instance, that has occurred during the monitoring period. And as a third selection we can do, we can either represent the results in linear units like meter, inches, or g, the gravitation in a constant, or we can represent them in dB, which is a logarithmic scale. Well, you certainly know logarithmic scaling, dB, always needs a reference value, and these reference levels are here laid down in the instrument. They are stored there. You can edit them if you want. These default values have been predefined in the instrument, but as I said, they can be edited if necessary. Some words about the sensors that we are offering. All sensors from NTI Audio are accelerometers, which is the standard type of sensor for vibration analysis. Most sensors are accelerometers, so they are actually giving out a voltage that is proportional to the acceleration of the vibration. Consequently, if you want to know the displacement or the velocity, you have to calculate these values from the acceleration data. The sensors we are selling are of type 1 axis. The power supply they need is type ICP, and their sensitivity can be stored in the ASD chip of the ICP adapter. The ICP adapter transfers the phantom power voltage coming from the XL2 into the ICP current source. And in this adapter, we have a chip, an automated sensor detection chip. This chip can store the sensitivity of the connected vibration sensor, accelerometer, and thus the XL2 instrument will always have the correct calculation base for its operation. Here we see the two models that we are offering. I will come back to them at a later point of this presentation. Now the measurements, coming to the measurements that we can execute with our instrument. First of all, the wideband level. You can select which ones you want to see on the display. You can select the time weighting, slow or fast, that has to be applied. You can alternatively also select the equivalent level over time or a gliding EQ value with 1, 2, 4, or 8 second time window. Wideband levels are typically used for monitoring the vibrations in buildings. Alternatively, you can also activate the oscilloscope of the XL2, which gives you a nice visualization of the incoming vibration signal. However, the most frequently used analysis method is the spectrum. CPB stands for constant percentage bandwidth. In the audio world, we would call it RTA, real-time analysis, but here in the vibration world, CPB is the more common, the more popular term. The spectrum can be either of the third octave or octave type, as you can see here, or high resolution FFT shown in the example below. The big advantage of spectral analysis is that it allows us to identify single signal components and measure them individually. Now, when we take a look at past fate analysis of samples coming out of a production line, for instance, we can do that with the wideband measurement, of course. However, in most cases, we would rather select the spectral analysis. Keep in mind that the tolerance mode in the XL2 that I'm going to show you later as well is connected to the spectral limits option. So you need this option on your XL2 device to execute this tolerance analysis. And the analysis goes like this. You first record a golden sample or maybe several golden samples. Based on this data, the instrument calculates the tolerance band, which is displayed as a gray band here. And now the test would compare the current curve versus this tolerance band, and it would indicate whether this measurement is beyond the limits or not. I will show you that in the presentation. And that's where we are. I have here on my desk an XL2 vibration meter with an ICP adapter and an accelerometer. You will see the content of the screen of my XL2 on the monitor via the XL2 Projector Pro software. And as device under test, I have here a test jig, which includes an electromotor and a gearbox, and I can manipulate that in order to generate out of balance state. Now let me switch over to the screen content of the XL2. What you see here is the calibration screen, and you see that apparently I have a microphone connected to my XL2. So for that, I will disconnect that microphone, and you see it says we are still in the sound level mode. Now, as soon as I connect the vibration sensor via the ICP adapter with the ASD chip, the XL2 automatically realizes now we have a vibration sensor connected. It asks me, shall I switch over to vibration mode? I confirm yes. Now the unit reboot very briefly, and now we are in the vibration mode. You can see that here. I could also activate this mode manually by moving my cursor to this entry and selecting the corresponding status if you do not have this ICP adapter with the ASD chip. Now, the next step would be to adjust the sensitivity of the sensor. And for that purpose, I'm going to briefly take a look at the data sheet of the sensor I have connected. And here you can read the sensitivity of it, 11.3 millivolt per meter per square second. So I keep this value in mind. I switch back to the Projector Pro, and now I can adjust the sensitivity correctly by using the Jogwheel 11.3. Please keep in mind that here the unit millivolt per meter per second square has to correspond to the entry here on the data sheet, because you can see I could also express it in millivolt per G alternatively. So this unit of course has to correspond to the one that I have selected here. This sensitivity is now stored on the ASD chip, so the next time I connect my vibration sensor to the XL2, the instrument will automatically read this sensitivity value and execute all further calculations correctly. Now let us take a look at the vibration. I have started my device under test now. You see here, this is the acceleration, the gliding equivalent value over 2 seconds for the acceleration. Here is the velocity over an 8 second gliding time period. And I have as a filter, I have a flat response, which means there is no filter active. I could, however, if requested, activate a 1 to 80 hertz low pass filter or 350 hertz low pass filter, or here the band pass filter if necessary. Taking a look at the units, I can switch over to milli G or to this dB value as stated before. Furthermore, I can, by pressing the page button, take a look at the spectrum. Here you see the spectrum of the incoming signal, and you see we have 1/3 octave resolution. And you see also that down here we have a lower frequency limit of 0.8 hertz. So this is the extended frequency bandwidth of the vibration mode compared to the audio mode where we start at 20 hertz, but with the vibration mode we go down to 0.8 hertz. Now, let us alternatively take a look at the high resolution FFT together with its tolerance mode. Here, this is the FFT signal that is coming in from my device under test. I could now save, or first of all, record this signal form over a certain time. You see down here on the right bottom corner, you see the recording time. Let us do that for 10 seconds. I stop the recording and I can save this result on the SD card. Furthermore, I can use this data as capture, as reference data for my tolerance mode, and I save it here on the C1 place. So it is saved. Now I can start tolerance mode based on this reference data. I could select, if I have saved several curves, I can select the one I want to have, or I can even calculate an average of several curves. And you see, because the situation has not changed, the current signal is within the limit. I can start another measurement. Doesn't have to go so long. Stop, you see it's passed. Now I'm gonna manipulate my device under test. Actually, I'm gonna, you're gonna see that very quickly. I restart the measurement. Apparently it looks different. You see the black bars up here, they show deviation of the current status versus the previous one. And as soon as I stop the recording, the red color indicates me that this measurement is out of tolerance. You see here in the menu that I have different options. Right now I have applied upper and lower limit to define my tolerance band, I could just select only the upper limit as the tolerance limit, or only the lower one. I can export or import these limits from the SD card to the SD card, and so on. I could manage different captures, so add more reference data to my database. So I have a lot of options. I just wanted to show you the basic operation of this mode. So let me get back to the presentation. Some summary information about what I've shown to you. When we talk about the XL2 vibration meter, we are able to analyze acceleration, velocity, or displacement. We can do that in three measurement modes: wideband, level, oscilloscope, or the spectrum analysis as third octave or FFT spectrum. We can measure down to 0.8 hertz, which is very important in the world of vibration. We have the challenge quite frequently to measure low frequencies. We can edit the dB references if necessary. And a very big advantage of the setup is the sensor data is stored in this ICP adapter, which allows us an automated switching back and forth between the sound level meter mode and the vibration meter mode. Sometimes we will ask which measurement should be applied, displacement, velocity, or acceleration. So I can give you some basic hints on that. The displacement measurement emphasizes the lower frequency components. You can imagine that quite well if you have a vibrating item, a cantilever, whatever. Rather, at low frequencies, you will see a displacement, whereas if the vibration frequency is very high, the displacement is almost hardly recognizable anymore. Maybe you remember this one graph I showed you with the three straight lines. The blue displacement line went down over the frequency axis, and that is giving us the indication that displacement is better used only for low frequencies. Velocity is a value that can be acquired over a pretty wide frequency range, whereas acceleration is mostly used or emphasizes the high frequencies in the spectrum. When we talk about sensors and their power supply, we have the A4580, which is a general purpose, very versatile sensor, starting at 3 Hz upward. Then we have the KS901, which is a very rugged sensor with a magnetic built-in head, and it has the frequency range starting at 0.8 Hz already. You can also use other vibration sensors. You are free. Just keep in mind, it has to be an acceleration type sensor, because the XL2 expects that the incoming signal, the incoming voltage from the sensor, represents the acceleration. There are some exotic sensors which can detect displacement or velocity directly. Don't use them. If you want to use another sensor, it has to be acceleration type. And last but not least, talking about our ICP supply, we recommend to use this device because it makes sure that you always have the correct data, the correct sensitivity applied for your calculations. Well, I'm at the end of from my side, I want to thank you very much for your attention. I hope I was able to answer most of your open issues, and I would like to see you again here at a future webinar, which we will announce as usual through our newsletter. Thank you very much for your attention. Have a good day, and bye-bye.